and not Tuesday was nonsense. That's the word that they use. Do you have any response to that?
Well, I don't think they mean that, and I think they it's the first time they've heard it like they heard it. And frankly, the people that were questioning that statement, was it too tough? Maybe it wasn't tough enough. They've been doing this to our country for a long time, for many years. And it's about time that somebody stuck up for the people of this country and for the people of other countries. So if anything, maybe that statement wasn't tough enough. And we're backed by 100% by our military. We're backed by everybody. And we're backed by many other leaders. And I noticed that many senators and others today came out very much in favor of what I said. But if anything, that statement may not be tough enough.
What would be tougher than fire and fury?
Well, you'll see. You'll see. We don't talk about that. I never do. I'm not like the other administration that would say we're going into Mosul in 4 months. I don't talk about it. We'll see what happens. But I can tell you that what they've been doing and what they've been getting away with is a tragedy, and it can't be allowed.
Well, that was before a briefing with his national security team. Afterwards, he said even more at a session that nearly amounted to a full-fledged press conference, which, of course, he hadn't had in months.
President, are you going to increase U.S. military presence in Asia?
We are going to look at what's happening in Asia. We're looking at it right now. We're constantly looking at it. I don't like to signal what I'm going to be doing, but we are certainly looking at it. And obviously, we're spending a lot of time looking at, in particular, North Korea. And we are preparing for many different alternative events at North Korea. He has disrespected our country greatly. He has said things that are horrific. And with me, he's not getting away with it. He got away with it for a long time between him and his family. He's not getting away with it. It's a whole new ballgame. And he's not going to be saying those things, and he's certainly not going to be doing those things. I read about we're in Guam by August 15th. Let's see what he does with Guam. He does something in Guam, it will be an event the likes of which nobody's seen before, what will happen in North Korea.
And when you say that, what do you mean?
You'll see. You'll see. And he'll see.
He
will see. It's not a dare. It's a statement. It has nothing to do with dare. That's a statement. He's not going to go around threatening Guam, and he's not going to threaten the United States, and he's not going to threaten Japan, and he's not going to threaten South Korea. No, that's not a dare, as you say. That is a statement of fact.
Well, North Korea weighed in as well earlier today, saying the United States, quote, would suffer a shameful defeat and final doom, their words, if it doesn't change course. Much more on that shortly. One other late note, we've just learned from several Defense Department officials that Joint Chiefs Chairman General Joseph Dunford has left on a visit to East Asia, including stops in Japan, China, as well as South Korea. Joining us now is retired Navy Rear Admiral John Kirby, retired Army Lieutenant General Mark Hurtling, Senior Chief Political Analyst Gloria Borger, and former CIA and FBI Senior Official Phil Mudd. General Hurtling, you know, if anybody thought the President was going to change his tone, he just seemed to have doubled down on fire and fury and set up some sort of whether challenge or basically kind of drew a line under the North Koreans' own date of August 15th in Guam.
It's 5 days away, Anderson. It's interesting because this is a guy who was elected because he was a great businessman and a great negotiator, and he's already going to the final option. It would be as if he was in his business and already going to suing before he tried to negotiate. The war of words is not good. It's never good on the diplomatic front. I'm not sure what he's trying to do. I thought he would camp it down. I thought some of his aides would get him to get it under control, especially General Kelly, maybe General Mattis and Secretary Tillerson, but they didn't. He should be the guy being quiet and let, in my view, and let his Secretary of State and his Secretary of Defense be either the good cop, bad cop, and him weigh in at the appropriate time. But that's not what's happening. And I think by doing that, he's limiting his option and making things a little bit tenser.
Admiral Kirby, I mean, again, he seems to be setting up a confrontation that somebody has to blink on August 15th.
Yeah, this is brinkmanship. I mean, it's playing chicken on a geopolitical scale. I still think there's room for diplomacy. And if you listen to Secretary Mattis today, when in his comments to the press, he still wants to stay in that diplomatic trade space. And I think there is still room for this. The problem is when he ratchets up, Trump ratchets up the rhetoric like this, he's closing down decision space. He's actually taken away some of that oxygen that Tillerson and Mattis want to have to play, let the diplomacy play out. Not to mention, he's forcing Kim Jong-un to also close down decision space. And it just takes us to a point where we don't need to be.
Gloria, I mean, it certainly, I guess, from a political standpoint, makes the president, seem like a decisive leader. And certainly for those who support the president, it's probably a welcome change of language.
Well, you know, he said, I'm not going to let them do this to us. And, what he meant was, Kim, you're not going to bully the United States of America. The problem is that it's kind of a tit for tat situation here. And so you have General Mattis, who is the leader of the armed forces, saying, trying to give North Korea some space there and say, look, stand down. And you have Tillerson saying, there, stand down. There's room for negotiation here. And you have the president not acknowledging that at all. So you're getting kind of mixed signals, and as John Kirby says, you're boxing Kim in to a degree. And what do you do? Do you look weak if then he ratchets it up and you don't respond?
Yeah, Phil, how do you see this?
Pretty simple. One-word choices, Anderson. That is, I remember being in the White House complex on September 11th of 2001. I was evacuated, walking around the streets of Washington, and you realize within 24, 48, 72 hours, and then when we realized with confirmation that Al-Qaeda from Afghanistan was responsible for that attack, the president, President Bush, had no option. He had no choice. In this case, the president has a lot of options. He could choose to focus on different issues, Russia, China, the opioid crisis, which you talked about today. I agree that North Korea is a potential nuclear threat. They are about a fifth world economic problem. They are on a flea on the ass of America. If the president wants to select North Korea as one of his priorities, my question would be why? Why do you want to do this? Why are you raising the profile of the North Korean leader to sort of an international celebrity by spending so much time on it? He doesn't have to do this, that is President Trump. He's choosing to make the North Korean leader a celebrity, and I don't know why. He doesn't have to do this.
It's interesting, Admiral Kirby. I mean, the U.S. has always avoided one-on-one discussions with North Korea, always wanting to have other countries involved as well. Almost for that very reason that Phil is talking about, of not having the North Korea on an equal footing with the United States and having it be kind of peer-to-peer, the president appears to be making it that eye-to-eye confrontation.
Yeah, no, I completely agree that he is playing right into Kim's propaganda and the way Kim tries to portray this as a U.S. versus DPRK problem, which we never wanted to make it. And in fact, it really isn't. I mean, the whole international community has now galvanized against these guys. But he's playing right into that rhetoric. And you got to remember that to Kim, the United States represents an existential threat. Now, I know we don't feel we are, and Tillerson said as much last week before we got to where we are now. But to them, we represent a power that is designed to wipe them off the face of the map. And so that's why when you throw this kind of rhetoric out there, you have to understand the ears that are going to be listening to it.
General Hertling, just from a military standpoint, General Hertling, if this does become a confrontation over Guam in 5 days, do you know just the logistics of if North Korea was to fire missiles heading that they said were going to head toward Guam and going to fall short? Would the U.S. have any idea as the missiles go off or as we're watching them go where exactly they are going and whether they would fall short? I mean, would the U.S. wait until, we saw what happened with those missiles?
No, you're going to pick them up off the launch pad. And I'm sure more intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance assets have been placed over North Korea because of all this action. You probably get all kinds of satellites, maybe some planes, maybe a lot of high-level drones, watching them 24 hours a day. When a heat signature goes off, you're immediately going to pick it up off the launch pad, off the truck that it's fired from, and there are going to be multiple layers of air defense from Korea through Japan through the Pacific to Guam. It isn't going to be like a catcher's mitt at Guam waiting for the missile to come in and then hitting it right before it strikes. You not only have land-based THAAD and PAC-3 missiles, you also have naval-based missiles. So you're going to pick those things up. And I would say there's a pretty good chance that none of those missiles are going to land unintended with some kind of casualty or a strike against him, a kinetic strike against him. But it, if you only get one through, it's traumatic. But going back to what both John and Phil just said, you know, it's all about choices. How do you pull them away from this? And why are we lowering ourselves to the level of North Korea?
Gloria, you were going to say something?
Well, yeah, I was going to say that just to make that point is that here you have the United States, which should get a lot of credit and a vote in the UN Security Council against North Korea. And why we're not isolating Kim and saying the entire international community stands against you and instead turning it into some mano-a-mano fight that gets ratcheted up between the president of the United States, of all people, and Kim. It seems absurd to me because the entire international community is with us. Mm. And we are not making that point very strongly from the bully pulpit, I don't think.
We got to take a
break. Well, if I could.
Sorry. Actually, General Herman, you could hold that thought. We got to take